Why you can't. That's quenching the Holy Spirit. And you lose the blessing, and so does he, but God will give it to that person some other way. He'll put it on so-and-so's heart to do it. You don't get the blessing, they do. But you, in the meantime, you quench the Holy Spirit, and therefore grieve God. Am I making it clear?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So I say it's an inside job, but you have a lot to do with it. Because you got that free will. So as you yield and surrender your will to God, you get more in tune with the Lord, and he can use you more. He'll speak to you more because he knows you're not going to grieve. You're not going to quench your spirit. You're going to obey the voice of God, and you're going to do the will of the Lord. Do the will of the Lord.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen? So you grow, you get blessed, and everybody your life touches gets blessed as well. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Whew. God goes to work on our hearts. Amen? If we let him. Why does God work on the heart? Why is it so important? Why are we talking about the inside job on the heart today? I'm going to tell you why. Because ever since the day you were born and they slapped you on your little hiney, come on, and you just run your mouth. You've been screaming ever since. Come on, somebody. Yeah, you've been crying ever since.
Yeah,
because see, the heart, the Bible says, let me just move on. I want to get ahead of myself. You already see where I'm coming from. Let me show you what I'm talking about from the Word of God.
Amen.
Ezekiel chapter 11, verses 19 and 20, talks about God giving his people, a new heart. Because the heart of flesh, the heart of sin, put it that way. The heart of sin needs to be replaced with the heart of God.
Amen.
God's heart. Yeah. Agape love. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'll also give them a new spirit. See, now we're spirit. We have our own spirit. He breathed the very breath of life in us, became a living soul, a living spirit. So we had our own spirit. But now God's spirit, when you get born again, God's spirit comes in. And he said his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God.
Amen.
Amen.
So there's two spirits. God's spirit, our spirit. Then when they connect, we should be one spirit with God.
Amen.
Follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Just like there's the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, but they're one. Because
yeah.
They're in one mind, one accord. Three different personalities, all the same still. All right, that's a whole other sermon. But anyhow, why else does he give it to us? Because he knows that the heart, he said in Ezekiel, is a heart of stone. We have hearts of stone, hard-hearted, before we meet Jesus. You just better hope and pray you don't keep that hard heart after you get saved.
That's right.
I've met some Christians, when they get saved, boy, they take that heart of stone, and God said, I'll turn it into a heart of flesh. That don't mean evil flesh. It means a heart that can feel, a heart of compassion, heart of love, the heart of God.
Amen.
That's what you get when you get born again. But they don't all keep it.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen them lose it. Through circumstances in life, heartaches in life, pain, suffering, sorrow, temptations, you name it, the list is endless. All the negative things that come against us on a regular basis, it can wear you out if you don't stay in tune with God. If you don't stay on your face, on your knees, and in the Word of God, it'll wear you out. And then little by little, the Bible talks about the root of bitterness. It's a root. Everybody knows a little bit about gardening. A tree can be strong and all that. It's so big around. You see these big, huge trees, but then a little storm comes by and they're flipped over because their roots wasn't deep.
Mm-hmm.
And it fell over when it shouldn't have, if its roots were deep. But then he goes on to say, but the roots go deep into bitterness. And out of the bitterness comes, he said, many roots. Of other kind. Jealousies, envy. He names them. Envy, strife, malice. He said all these things are not of God. Don't belong in a Christian's life, in their thoughts, or in their heart as well.
Amen.
So that's what I'm trying to say is what happens is if we're not careful, little by little, that root of bitterness turns into bigger roots, deeper roots, and then their heart gets hard again, and you start to see the ugly come out again. And you can see it being done week by week in front of you as you see them, know them, talk to them, fellowship with them. And well, they used to be soft-hearted. They used to be merciful. They used to be tender-hearted. They used to be thankful. And now they're talking mean and want revenge and putting down their brothers and their sisters and finding fault with everybody. You know, their love is gone. The mercy's gone. The compassion's gone. A heart of stone all over again. Dangerous, and still think they're saved because they can still talk in tongues.
Jesus.
Or they can still do their little thing, or still sing, play this, whatever. You don't lose that unless you totally backslide and walk away from the church. More dangerous, at least we know where they're at. They're backsliding. But what more dangerous than that is to think you're saved and not be saved. Because your heart turned back into a heart of stone, and that mean spirit came back on you. Because we were all mean and ugly at one time. Don't look at me like that. We're all mean and ugly.
That's right.
When we don't have Jesus.
Yes.
But when that devil comes back on you, and you start being ugly, and when you know better, there is no excuse. And then, therefore, that's the danger zone. So that's why God has to give us a new heart and a new spirit.
Yes.
And it's up to us. That's why I said the free will. It's up to us to keep it and protect it.
Yes.
We're the watchmen,
yes,
of our own hearts and souls. We're the watchmen of our own minds. We can't expect everybody to be worried and taking care of us. We got to take care of ourselves through the power of the Word of God and the Spirit of God.
Yes.
He gave us every ammunition, every tool, every piece of armor we'll ever need.
Amen.
You can't survive on one sermon a week.
That's right.
You'll starve to death if you only ate one meal a week. Eventually, you'll be anemic. And you'll starve, and you'll get sick. And you'll have all kinds of physical problems and mental problems because your brain needs food as well. And you'll fall apart within months.
That's right.
Same thing spiritually.
Yes.
You cannot live off of one sermon a week. If you ain't reading your word every day,
yes,
the word of God, if you ain't praying every day, Come on now. I'm telling you, if you ain't having some times of fellowship with God, meditating on His Word, if we would listen to that, if we would put as much energy and effort into that, instead of woe is me, my God, we'd be giants for Jesus.
Amen.
Giants for Jesus. But we get into that mode, we feel sorry for ourselves, pity party, and that's the opposite of faith. It's opposite of trust in God. And the Bible said, let that person think he received nothing good from the Lord. I don't care how much Bible you know.
That's right.
God cares how much you live in. Anybody glad you came today?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. I wouldn't miss this for the world.
Yes,
preach it, brother.
Hallelujah.
Yes,
right.
Woo.
Right.
You don't step on my toes, you ain't told me nothing.
Right.
It'll get better.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
But right now we're sticking with it. Amen. Because we all need to hear this.
Yes.
I'm blessing myself.
Yes.
Glory be to God. I can hardly wait to hear what the Holy Ghost is going to say next.
Amen.
I got to get back to my notes here. Joel chapter 2 verse 13. Here we go now. God said, rent your heart. Rent it. Rip it. Rip it over. Rent your heart, not your garments. See, because back in them days, when they were grieving or when they sinned or whatever, they'd throw dust in their hair. Can you imagine that? And they'd rip their clothes as a sign of grief and sorrow and repentance.
Yes.
He said, nah, 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 nah. Don't rip your clothes. Rip your heart.
Yes.
Rip it open so that I can doctor it up.
Yes.
Rip it open so I can fill it with the good things of God.
Yes.
Take out the negative, the bad.
Yes.
That's what he's saying. Rent your heart, not your garments. Listen. Ooh.
Jesus.
And he says, then God will be slow. Listen, rent your hearts, net your garments, and turn. Here's another very important key. Turn. That means change your mind, change your heart, change your way you're thinking. Turn.
Yes.
Unto the Lord your God. For he, come on now. For he is gracious,
yes,
and merciful and slow to anger, and of great kindness and repented him of the evil.
Yes.
Now, what's that mean? Boy, that last part, what? Wow. God has to repent? God can do evil? Not like we know it. When you understand the word of God, he's saying, if you will turn and wrench your heart, in other words, if you will repent and change your mind, change your course, and let me guide you and lead you, I will turn away my anger,
yes,
and what I planned on doing to you.
Jesus.
Amen.
I'll change my mind about the evil I was going to lay on you.
Jesus.
That's all it's talking about.
Yes.
Plain language. I'll repent. We're not like we repent. He said, I'll be sorry, in other words. Repent means be sorry, right?
Yeah. Yes.
He said, I'll be sorry for the plans I had of evil that I was going to allow to happen to you, because you wouldn't rip your heart open and let me in there and be obedient and stop making all the excuses and cop-outs and walk the walk and talk the talk. Then I'll change my mind. Woo, because the Bible says, I believe it's Jeremiah, he said, God makes alive and God kills. He said, it's a terrible thing to have God as your enemy.
Whew.
I got a lot of enemies over the years for whatever reason, but let me tell you, I don't want God to be my enemy. I can promise you that. You don't want God to be angry at you. And all he's asking is a normal thing,
yes,
to his children.
Jesus.
Love me. Jesus. Obey me. So it's so much better. It'll be so much of an easier life for you.
That's right.
The path will be made crooked. The crooked path will be made straight.
Yes, yes, Lord.
I'll give you springs in the desert type of things.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on. I'll take you to a higher height, deeper depths in knowledge and wisdom and understand.
Yes.
But you got to want it. You know,
yes.
You know who this is for? Come on, really. You know who this is for?
God.
For whosoever.
Yes.
Thank God he's not respecter of persons. I wouldn't be here.
That's right.
Jesus.
Amen.
Thank God he doesn't judge from the outward appearance. I wouldn't have had a shot.
Jesus, thank you.
Wouldn't have had a shot at it. But he looks on the heart.
Yes.
And when he sees that heart wants him more than anything else, anybody else, you got favor with God. God will say, get out the way, all you devils. Here he comes. Get out the way, all you naysayers. Here she comes.
Yes.
Huh? Get out of the way, all you doubters and patterns. I'm cutting them loose. And you can't stop them, because my Bible says nobody can shut the door that the Lord opens. And if he don't want you to go through, he said nobody's going to open a door that I shut. So if you ain't getting the blessings you think you deserve, check the lock on the door. Is it on the inside? Or